Hey Mo, we need to get an intro down for this channel, you know.
Yeah, but what are you thinking, Lee?
Why not a rap over the top of it?
Don't be ridiculous, you sound like a northern Eminem.
Look, listen to me. Yo, yo, yo. The Munch Brunch in the house, man.
Absolutely not.
Right, what you got in mind?
Let's just keep it simple.
I'm Lee.
I'm Aime.
We're the Munch Brunch.
To another mukbang with Aime and Lee. We are the Munch Brunch UK. Lee, tell them, what would you have on the menu today?
Aime, it is lunch, sort of breakfast, brunch. I said the other day I don't do brunch, guess I am now. We're having breakfast sandwiches. So Aime has egg, bacon, sausage and hash brown. No tomatoes, I've got to put them on. I have sausage, hash brown and egg.
Yeah.
No bacon for me, I'm afraid. Ketchup, brown sauce for Aime.
No, not ketchup, Ambrose, just brown sauce.
I've got the ketchup, as you can see.
I've got the brown sauce.
Yes, and we've got the brown sauce.
Yeah, exactly. And today, guys, I'm going to be doing
God,
crime stories part two.
Here we are.
But we're going to eat a little bit first, do a little bit of talking, and then I'm going to get into it. So we're back, everybody. We can't get the lighting quite right today because it's light outside. We're using warm lighting, which is better to use when it's darker. So we're just going to have to run with it, aren't we? But anyway, crime stories part two. This is a real crazy story, guys.
Crazy times.
But first things
we'll get
first.
Into that in a bit. I'm on the coffee. Aime's on the lemon and lime. Lime squash, I think it is. Who else drinks pop with breakfast food, like cup breakfast?
I do like a cup of tea with... I've always said
oh,
to...
Oh, God, look at that for a run here. It's just gone everywhere.
I've always said, like... My mum and dad used to drink tea with their main meal. And I never deemed that as, oh, how can you do that? However, I do like it, drinking tea. Goodness sake. Well, that's
good. Hash brown alert. How are we all? Hit the thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already. Have yourself a breakfast sandwich if you've not had one in a while.
What is your favourite breakfast sandwich? Now, my mum, she just likes bacon.
I just used to have sausage as a kid for a long time.
No, when we go away, well, not away, but when we go to, like, Morecambe, we usually jump on the train, and at the train station, we always get these sausage back things, don't we, from that shop. They're lovely.
Pretty expensive, I mean, for what they are, like half the size of this, you pay about £3
off for it.
This
just reminded me slightly of it.
It's a good toast, this is.
Yeah, definitely. Got some big, large baps from.
We do have some big baps. But anyway, what's everyone up to? How are you doing?
We're nearly at the weekend.
It's been a slow bloody week this week for me. I don't know why. Yeah, I woke up to that. Oh, it's Friday today. I was like, no, it's still wet Thursday. Got another bloody day to get through yet.
I genuinely thought yesterday was Thursday. I really believed that. Yeah, not so much today. But yesterday, I thought it was Thursday.
We went shopping yesterday. Now, when I was a kid, with my mum, Friday night was our shopping time. Did anyone else have a shopping day?
Friday big shop.
Every week, at a set time, usually about 6. My dad would come home for dinner because he was a taxi driver during the day. Well, on weekends, rather.
As in lunch, then?
Dinner time, man.
Like 5 o'clock?
No, I'd be at school during the day.
I say, like, what I mean is, like, 1 o'clock-ish.
My dad would come home for his dinner. If you're from the north, you know what time dinner is. It's like 5, 6 o'clock.
Oh, I thought dinner, like your mum said dinner and it's like 1 o'clock.
I call it dinner now because I'm from down here now.
Absolutely.
Oh my giddy God. Dinner time around here is tea time up there. I would call it tea time. I'd say, Mum, what's for tea?
My mum does that.
Yeah, no, because it's normal. Anyways, about 5 or 6 o'clock, my dad would come home with his tea and then he'd always take us to Asda for a Friday night shop. I'd pick up loads of crap. My mum's bill would be way over what it should have been. And I couldn't comprehend money. I was a kid. I was like, Mum, can I have this? Can I have that? Can I have this? Can I have that? She, yeah, put it all in. She goes, oh my. I never used to see her stressing about it. I can guarantee now, looking back, she probably got really worked up about how much extra I'd pick up. But when was your big shop day? Do you have one?
Usually on a Tuesday. My nan. And
yeah,
they'd go to the
I need to use it.
They'd go to the cafe in there, and that was like a thing that we did every single Tuesday. Because I thought if we went on a Friday, it'd be absolutely packed.
It generally isn't it? Because everyone has the same bloody idea. Let's do the shopping on Friday.
We tried so many different strategies to get away with the rush. Going at 11 o'clock at night.
The best one was when this... It's not a recent thing, is it? I mean, it's when we were teenagers sort of thing. But they started doing 24-hour shopping at Asda and whatnot. Sainsbury's still don't do it, which is odd. Well, not our one doesn't. But Asda do it. And then you can just go out late at night. Or my mum would say to me, Dad, can you pick up something or other from Asda? And you're like, yeah, right, I finish work at 2 in the morning. I'll fly by whilst it's... Yeah, go in there. Christmas shopping we used to do. Big food shop at Christmas. Empty.
We still do that now, don't we?
Yeah, but it's absolutely quiet. No, I'd go at like 2 in the morning though, my mum, when she'd finished work or whatever. Everybody's like, quiet as a mouse. I'm like, wow, you got a whole shop to yourself.
We've always sort of done that. It's not as though you carried on the tradition necessarily, but we've always done it late at night. It's just something that we choose to do on a Christmas time. It's going late at night. It's just something makes it more Christmassy, doesn't it?
I don't know. You just like to do it, does my buddy Eddie, if I'm being completely honest. I've got to age now where I hate shopping. If you're a bloke, you know what I'm on about. Shopping is a pain in the arse.
So when it was yesterday.
When I'm told we've got to go shop, oh, for God's sake, not again. Can't be arsed with it.
However, it was better going yesterday rather than online. I know you can look online at stuff. But at the same time, it's kind of nice to see what you're buying sometimes.
Yeah, but these lot here, people watching now, don't have to put your mum's shopping list. We needed a separate shopping trip just around mum's list. Huh. Crazy. How's everyone feeling about passports for pub, or papers for pubs it's called? The new rule, apparently, is going to be, if you want to go to the pub, if you've not had a vaccination, because a lot of people say, I ain't getting it done, I refuse to, well, there's a chance you'll be refused a pint in the pub. You have to have, like, they're on about adding it onto your track and trace app, where you show it, and then, like, it'll show that you've had the vaccination or not. And if you haven't had it done, there's a good chance they're going to, like, say no.
What about if you haven't got a smartphone or an Android?
Well, there is that. That's what they're also on about having it, is a paper form. But the only thing they're saying is, like, they're not going to be able to regulate necessarily because pubs will not necessarily back it.
Is it to the pub's discretion, Mark?
Well, yeah. It's going to be the law to do it, but the pubs have the right. Well, the pubs have already said this one, a landlady said, I ain't going to ask all my punters if they've got this vaccination. You know, I just want to get back to normality. I want people to feel like it's a place they can go and relax. Mm. Not where they're going to have to stress.
What about for people who medically can't have it?
I don't know. They won't be allowed in until things get more settled.
Well, according to Boris, that'll be sometime in June.
Yeah, I've heard today differently.
I was looking at the steps out yesterday. You know, step one, step two, three and four. Four being the last one in June. It just says, no limitations on anything. You can have as many people as you want around, as many people in concerts. I can't see that happening just yet.
Talking about all this, for anyone who is thinking, it's a bit of a, you can thank me later for this because I'm going to save you a lot of money now. Anyone who's had the idea, oh, we'll book a holiday now, and put it on our credit card, and at least if it gets cancelled, we'll be covered. You won't be. Apparently, there's some sort of law rule in section 75 of something or other, which says, with this new lockdown, whatever you book on a credit card is not covered, whether it be concerts, holidays, whatever it might be, meals, you won't be insured. So if you book an holiday now for June, and then there's another lockdown in place, you're going to lose your deposit. So don't book anything until it's official. We all can do what the hell we want. Ain't worth the risk.
Mm-mm. Obviously, there's some holiday sites that say they have paid, like, obviously, the insurance to say if it gets cancelled, you can have your deposit back.
I don't think there is, though, not with this lockdown. That's the whole point. Because companies are going to lose too much money if they do that.
Is that if there's a knock and do lockdown?
Yeah, if, we're not out of lockdown, are we? We're not officially allowed to book holidays at the minute. This whole June 21st thing is just, at the very earliest, we'll be out of it, is June 21st. They're not saying, oh, don't worry, June 21st, everything goes back to normal. They're just saying social distancing will be allowed from June 21st, which I heard today means you'll be allowed to meet in more than groups of six. It doesn't mean you'll be allowed to go and have a rave and go to concerts and stuff. So you got to wait until
that.
Presumably,
said the remaining things would be nightclubs and that happen in June. I hope so. Not nightclubs, but...
The problem they have, though, is that a lot of these... apparently, the UK, Israel and America have like stockpiled all the vaccinations. So like countries like Germany and stuff haven't been able to get hold of enough.
Anyway, enough of COVID. Let's start my true crime. Now, this one's a little bit more dated. Just having a bite.
Just having a nibble and then we'll crack on. Look at this. Always a little pile of bread from her. Every time. You like a bloody mouse. Just stockpiling a little bit.
I'm bread then.
I'm alright, so.
Alright.
Set the scene, Amo. Whoa. No. Not sticky fingers. Now, what period of time is this?
Okay.
Like Charles Dickens.
Now, this is in the 1500s, including the 1600s. Okay, so this story I actually got off a Facebook makeup artist. She does like some really good stories. And I'm going to link her name, or Lee will, in the description down below. So you can go check her out on Facebook. But this is just a story that when I heard it, I thought, wow, I've got to tell you guys all about it because it's really interesting.
If I forget to do it, link it, and you want to know, ask me in the comments and I'll find out what it is.
Okay, so her name was Elizabeth Bathory. She was a Hungarian noblewoman of a noble family, Bathory. She was born 7th of August, 1560, and died 21st of August, 1614. Her name was deemed Countess Blood or Countess Dracula.
That was her name?
Her name was Elizabeth Bathory, but they kind of nicknamed her Countess Blood or Countess Dracula.
Well, you won't mess with somebody with that name, okay. Of course.
Now, she was labelled, actually, in the Guinness World Records as being the most prolific female murderer. And it was debated of how many victims she had. She had, like, they said around about 700. She had four collaborators, and they were all accused of torturing and killing hundreds of girls and women between 1590 and 1610. And it was thought that she had around, like I said, between 650 and 700 victims.
What, mate?
700 victims. I mean, my God.
Back then you could get away with stuff like that, couldn't you?
Big time. As a child, she suffered from multiple seizures, which in today's age, they believe is epilepsy. Possibly from the inbreeding of her parents. Now, that is not to say, obviously, that people with epilepsy have that issue now, but back then, that's what
caused... They didn't know what caused it.
Yeah, but they believed that inbreeding was a part of the seizures. Their treatment for this included rubbing blood of a non-sufferer on the lips of the epileptic, or giving them a piece of a non-sufferer's skull and putting blood on their lips from a non-sufferer. It's like a combination.
What to do with the skull, though?
They'd just give it them.
What, to eat?
No, just like, to have. Yeah.
All right.
Some say that the killings contributed to trying to cure her of her illness in later life. And there was speculation she was trying to be cruel by her family, who were thought to be into Satanism, witchcraft, but there was no hard evidence of that one. It was speculation against the town folk.
This
is
why I'm glad we've got the NHS, because all them witch doctors back then, I couldn't be doing a bit. Yeah, have a bit of skulls, get rid of your COVID.
Now, from the age of 10, this is, she was introduced to the idea that she'd have to marry at an early age.
Okay.
So, when she was 13, before her first marriage, it was said she had gave birth to the child of a boy. But it was a peasant boy. The father of the child was a peasant boy out of the village that surrounded their area. The child was taken away and given to a local woman who was trusted by the family. So basically, she was due to be married to this count, which I'll come on to in a minute. Instead, she got pregnant by a peasant boy, which of course the whole family was absolutely furious for. So the baby was taken away and gave it to this woman who was a friend of the family and got trusted basically with it. At the age of 10, she was engaged to a Ferenc Nadasty. Ferenc.
Sort of like Frank.
Yeah, but Ferenc Nadasty.
It's Hungarian for Frank.
Mm. They were married when she was 15 and the count was 19 at the time. On May 8th, 1575, approximately 4,500 guests were invited to the count's wedding. Also, his gift to Elizabeth Bathory was his castle. The family owned a castle, and he gave this to her. His mother signed the rights over to them on their wedding day, and that was it.
Hang on, has your mum not got a castle we could have after I married you?
In 1578, the count became the chief commander of the Hungarian troops and led them to war. Meanwhile, whilst he was away, Elizabeth was to manage the estate and the businesses in the surrounding village. Some time passed, and Elizabeth and the count had children, which isn't really relevant to the story right now. However, Ferenc Nadasty came back from the long war and died on January the 4th at the age of 48. He had been married to Elizabeth for 29 years before dying. The count had entrusted his heirs and his widow to Gregory Thorzo, who was eventually to lead the investigation into Bathory's crimes. So he was like his friend, and he was like, right, I want you to be able to look after my wife, make sure all my heirs are sorted.
Crimes, you just said.
Yes, basically, this Gregory Thorzo was the count's friend, and he says, I want you to look after my wife, I want you to deal with all my heirs, my widow and everything.
What about my crimes, what was that bit?
Because I'm coming on to that now. So he would eventually, this Thorzo would eventually lead the investigation to Elizabeth's crimes.
And he was friends with her former husband. Yeah. Right, got you.
Rumours started to spread between 1602 and 1604 of Elizabeth's atrocities. And in 1610, they assigned Thorzo to investigate. By 1611, Thorzo had collected over 3,000 witness statements.
How did they get all them?
300 witness statements.
Were they the ones she didn't kill?
No, but like obviously those victims that had been killed, he got information from the town folk who was too scared to basically speak up.
Because she was like a queen or something in the area.
Well, she was the countess, so she was the count. She was a noble woman, so they was deemed like a very high up people. You don't speak. It's like speaking against the queen back then.
But yeah, Donald Trump trying to talk against him.
Elizabeth's first victims were said to be girls aged between 10 and 14. She started killing daughters of lesser gentry whose parents sent them off to learn, like, etiquette. Like, to speak really nice and proper. It was said that Elizabeth... Now, listen to this, guys. This is where it gets really bad. It was said that Elizabeth used to take them and do extreme things, including severe beatings, burning or mutilation of hands, biting the flesh off their faces, arms, legs, other body parts, freezing or starving them to death. Needles were also pushed into them for no reason. The girls were burned with hot tongs. Then they were placed in freezing cold water, which is said to be absolutely torture. Some were covered in honey and put into a bed of live ants.
So this isn't when they were dead?
This is when they were tortured before they died.
Not me.
And then there was also speculation of cannibalism. Bodies were found all over the place, some in unmarked locations, graveyards, but not with proper burial sites, if so to speak. Some of the girls were sent, obviously, to learn etiquette, as I've just said, and their bodies were also... had traces of major and extreme torture before the point of death. It was then decided that Elizabeth had enough evidence on Elizabeth against her. So on December 30th, 1610, Thorsdale went to the castle and arrested Elizabeth and her four servants, because they were the ones who were supporting her in the act, because they felt really scared of her and they knew they had to help her with these killings.
Did they used to bring the kids, or the kids were sent there, weren't they?
But they basically aided her in these crimes because they were so terrified of her. Well, you're going to be, aren't you?
Yeah, she'll be Count Dracula.
When he arrived there, she was thought to be just having dinner, but she was actually caught in the act because she was all covered in blood. She was completely...
It's a bit of a giveaway, isn't it, really?
Yeah. She was completely, completely covered in blood. After he caught her in this state of having dinner with covered in blood, it was then agreed that she'd be kept under strict house arrest inside the castle, and no further punishment should be avoided. The four servants confessed and were quickly executed, basically because the king at the time, or the queen, but I think it was the king, didn't want them to find out about the bad news at the castle and ruin the reputation.
Got you.
So what happened to this woman? Elizabeth Bathory was locked in a bricked room, and was she to roam around freely in the room, confined to her own castle. Her castle then became her prison. They didn't want her to be executed because she was such a high status. It had caused bad news for their family. It looked really bad. It looked bad on the kingdom and everything. So basically, she was locked in a bricked room. They bricked her in inside the room. So the room had already been bricked, but then they did an inner layer of brick, so she couldn't get out at all. And then, from her quarters, on the evening of August the 20th, she complained to her bodyguard that stood outside her door that her hands were freezing cold. He replied, "Oh, it's nothing, just go back to bed and lie down." She was found dead the following morning, and the location of her grave to this day is unknown. And she's the Countess Dracula, or Blood, for what she used to do with 700 victims, it's been said.
So we don't know if Dracula come before her, do we, really? Well, Dracula was a book, wasn't it? Or they actually said it was based on a real person, Dracula. I don't know.
It was all to do with the fact that she killed all these victims, obviously, to try and clear up her seizures, which today, in the world today, it's epilepsy.
Yeah, if you're NHS, back then, they just give her a tablet. But back then, nowadays you get a tablet, back then they just kill a load of kids, a load of people.
I mean, just to think this actually happened, this isn't like... I mean, you hear crime stories of today, but to think back then, you know, chopping off bits of girls' hands, biting faces, burning them, torturing them. It just made her feel good about herself.
You think about it. We was whinging, or I was, the other day about the royal family and the racism stuff with Harry and Meghan and whatnot. Royal family's always been a bit of a bastard because they can get away with it.
Well,
but our ones,
this was a noble
good
family
compared to them.
Yeah, like...
Wasn't the queen, was she? Did she marry a king?
She married a count.
Ah.
She was the family was a noble family. The Bathory family was like a high status family.
So it's like if Downton Abbey started killing people.
Sort of, yeah. Like there was a high status family. So, you know, they didn't want to become across in the kingdom as bad people. So that's why she wasn't executed. The ones, like the servants that was admittedly a part of the act, they was hush-hush quickly killed before anybody knowing. So let's say, like, we have the 10 o'clock news.
Yeah.
Today, three people were found, like, betting and aiding such and such and such. They didn't want none of that, so they was like, shh, come on, let's get them killed off, and then let's keep her in a room. So basically the kingdom didn't find out
about it.
Yeah,
that stuff happens now,
because it's
though
embarrassing that they was a noble family, supposed to be, like, you know, a family back then. You kind of look up to that main family in the mansions and stuff. Kind of like Downton Abbey.
Kind of like the royals. Oh, let's keep quiet about what's
like
his name,
that.
The son.
It's not like that. It's more like Downton Abbey, where like they do things like the pillars of the community. They do things with charity. They give a lot away to people who are underprivileged. They're supposed to help young kids, like, look up and see what they can do. And of course, the king at the time didn't want all that, like, well, why have you let this happen type of thing come out, because it'd look bad on everything in the kingdom and everything. But just to think, though, all that was going on because her parents thought it was the right thing to do to rub blood and, on their lips and because to get rid of the epilepsy. It's crazy to think that.
I mean, she could have used the excuse, I am a countess from Hungary and I'm hungry. That's why I ate all the people.
Well, she bit the faces off and things. It was just a weird situation. I just think...
I think they should make a series about the woman, to be honest. Might be quite popular.
But yeah, I thought I'd give you a little bit of a story about something happened hundreds of years ago because it just seems...
Barney.
Without now justice system in place, like I told you with the last one, it just seems a bit like torture sort of story, this one does, doesn't it? Like,
yeah, you won't mess with her, would you? I mean, you certainly, she invited you around for dinner. I'll have to think twice about it. I say, look, Bathory, love, whatever your name is, Helen or whatever.
Elizabeth Bathory.
Elizabeth, right, love. I know you want me to come for dinner. I know you want to eat my Yorkshire puddings, but I don't think it's a good idea. I think it's best that you have your dinner in one room and I'll have mine in another country over there somewhere because it could get a bit messy.
Okay, so...
She's got a picture. Been in touch with a woman?
Shortly.
Now you can see it.
Sorry, guys. Tia rang. And I had to answer the phone. So, this is her. Can you see her?
Yeah, she looks like a dodgy one, doesn't she?
She just... it's just...
Then again, it might just be the way... the lighting when the bloke drew the picture of her or painted her. She might just be a real lovely lady.
Probably, oh, yeah, really lovely.
Yeah, probably likes knitting in the mornings and a bit of croquet in the afternoon, eating people in the evening.
So this is probably a better picture.
I don't know, it makes it look weird.
No, what I mean is, like, you get a better idea of what she looks like.
She's got a really tiny head for a big body.
It's the dress. It's the dress. But you got to remember that time they wore, like, them puffy dresses and stuff. But, yeah, I just thought I'd give you an old-time crime story. She is deemed as a serial killer.
But think about it, though. Ow, sugar me head. Like back then, when there was an NHS, there was only like potions and bloody magic mushrooms and stuff.
A lot of it back then was believed to be like witchcraft.
Yeah.
Like what do they call them doctors? Like
witch doctors.
Yeah, like witch doctors and thinking that you could solve things with like...
Apothecaries.
Rubbing like some rosemary on your or sprinkling...
Bit of bird shit on your head. But no, if it works though, she was discovering that it was working. Like, oh, buddy, I've not had a seizure in like a week. Then why won't she carry on?
It's like psychosomatic though, isn't it? Like, oh, you know, you believe in your head sometimes. The power of the mind has such an influence on how you're feeling. Like, so if you can create pain in your head, like if you've got the ability, I can do that. Like if I could take pain away sometimes if you just convince your mind that it's not there.
Got you.
But back then, like, if you believe in something, like, oh, yeah, I really believe that this is working, your mind tends to think
to
it's true.
It.
Yeah? So she obviously... And bear in mind, obviously, this woman did terrible things. But if she was brought up in a family that was... It was said to be the right thing to do, how on earth is she supposed to differentiate at 10 years of age when she was married and, like, giving birth to children, what right from wrong was?
Oh, you got to remember, it's also the time, like, Henry VIII, who had, like, 50,000 wives. Oh, I don't like Sue anymore. Off with her head. Bring Pat in. Now, Pat's not got it going for me anymore. Knock her head off. He just used to kill him willy-nilly, didn't he?
And I'm not sure if it was the time of Henry VIII.
When was he around? Like, what, 80s, 90s?
Jockey.
It was, like, the 1600s, wasn't it? We don't need to find out now. We can wrap this up.
I'm going to look now.
She's going to look now. When our mate Henry was around.
When was Henry VIII about?
About. When was Henry VIII about?
Here is information from Wikipedia. Oh, I don't know. 1547. Well, he was born 1491. Yeah, and he died at 1547.
When was she around? In the 1500s, weren't it?
It was more the 1600s, so it was a little bit after
He might have known her uncle, Pete. Just pop around for a cup of tea one afternoon.
His name wouldn't have been Pete, and that is not would have been happening. They'd have probably been
Pietro. That's what they call it. Pietro. Come and have a cup of tea, man.
If you like these kind of videos and you want to hear a different type of video to that,
I've got one for next time.
That's absolutely fine. But I've got a really, really amazing one. This is modern day. So what I thought I could do was, do you like a modern day one and then an old style one? So like. Old version torture, like that one, like different things that they used to do in the early 100 years, like, so to speak.
Early 100 years?
No, like the I don't know.
Early what centuries. Range
yeah. And then, like, obviously, I'll take it to the modern day the next time. I just think it'd be really cool. And it's so interesting when you're actually reading and hearing some of these stories. Like, these things actually happened. It's not like EastEnders. That is not true.
Well,
these
I've got one for next happened. Time.
Yeah. But he won't do it now. You said you was going
to
do
it. I was happy to do it today, but you had a really good one. So I had to wait. I'm happy to wait.
Well, we can still do it.
My one involves a bloke burying people in his back garden. So we'll get in another country.
His name's Jimmy Corgill, and he used to be on Brookside.
You'd have a job, Amy. His name was Corkill, not Corgill.
No, whatever.
Right, guys, thank you. We're going to go now. Amy's going to finish this off later on, I guess.
Oh, I don't want it.
She's full now. Barney can have it.
Anyway, guys, if you like it, let us know in the comments what you think. If you'd like to keep up with these stories, if you enjoy them. And remember to be calm, remember to be nice, comment, share, like, and subscribe. Don't forget to turn on your notification bell so you don't miss any future videos. Check us out on our Munchies Delights channel, that's our vlog channel, and our Instagram, which is all descripted below. And also, check out the community tab. Oh, and press the all button on your thing. You know, your button, your bell.
All videos notified.
So you don't miss any future ones there.
Yeah, guys. Don't bloody miss them, or we'll send Liz round to get you. Resurrect her.
You'll have a job.
We'll resurrect the bitch. Come to get you at a place near you real soon.
Okay, guys, see you later. Bye.
Laters.